Warm welcome to all of you. To realize the vision of increasing our manufacturing contribution from the current 16% to 25% of our GDP by 2025 calls for a considerable paradigm shift in the way we run our manufacturing enterprises. This necessitates adoption and integration of smart and digital technologies in our entire manufacturing ecosystem, including our suppliers and service providers. The challenges in so doing are enormous. Digitalization, Internet of Things, Industry 4.0, smart manufacturing, robotized automation, with all their supporting technology enablers, throw up mind-boggling array of issues on our to-do list. The questions are where to begin, how quickly to progress down the road. We look forward to your guidance, sir, in your presentation on winning in the digital world. Time. With these few words, may I present to you the thinker par excellence, Sri Mohandas Pai.
Sir. This is about winning in the digital world, because what is happening today is the impact of how the world is changing due to the digital disruption that's happening. This chart says it all. 7.6 billion people on the planet, 5.1 billion people have mobile, are unique mobile users, 4.4 billion are internet users. They're all on social media. The world has changed because the existing industrial system was based upon the industrial revolution, where you had a manufacturer, you had component manufacturer suppliers, then you had a consumer, you had a supply chain through transportation, through storage, to banking, etc., and you had to go through this chain. Now you can approach the consumer directly for many goods and services, so the entire system is getting disrupted and the value in the middle is getting constricted, and this is unleashing forces. And second, the rise of China is a very, very big impact on the world, which you're seeing right now. India too is following that. We have 1.2 billion mobile connections, 560 the entire supply chain come down, and you're going to have evidence-based decision making. Now, this is a key slide to show you the convergence of technology across many areas. Big data, analytics, IoT, AI, quantum computing is all coming together in a shorter period of time, because the cycles earlier were long, so you could reconfigure. Well, the cycles are very short. When cycles are very short, at the market, the economies are flush with money, not in India though, we're short of money here, then everything gets impacted very rapidly. Labor productivity has been stagnating for many years. I'm taking the advanced countries because we are still not there. And now labor productivity has been stagnating primarily because machines have come to be ubiquitous and people are using the machines, but they're not seeing an increase in productivity. So you need a quantum jump in computing power, in AI, to bring back labor productivity to reduce costs, because costs are going up. Now, this is a very dense chart, just look at it. So digitization is going to impact all industries. You can see the industries at the bottom: mining, real estate, agriculture, transportation, utilities, construction, every other industries, and in very different ways. So the value in all those industries is going to shrink. Combined effect of digitization industry, the consumer industry is impacted the most, and the great value and the jobs are going to come down. This is by a survey, and then automotive, where you are involved, there the jobs may not go up, may not come down, may remain the same, but then there's going to be great impact. Now, you know that a EV vehicle has got only 20 moving parts, it's an electric motor, and then a IC engine has got 2,000 moving parts. A EV costs only $1,500 a year to maintain in the US, whereas an IC costs $10,500. And last year, the world made 1.5 million EV vehicles. This year, maybe 2 million, and China is driving it. And EVs can run for 500,000 kilometers without dying. Now, you make money because the car dies, because all moving parts. When you have an electric motor run with autonomously, then you are in a different world altogether. You can see all these industries which are going to get impacted. They're going to impact the utility industry, is going to impact the logistic industry, the aviation industry, etc. Return on industry by technology, if you look at this, the leaders will always make more money, and the delta between the leaders and the followers is going to expand, because those who innovate are the ones who are going to make more money. So you've got to be ahead of the curve. You've got to be faster than anybody else. And now we are seeing data right from 2006, how leaders are getting far ahead of followers. How has digital changed China? China enjoys a scale advantage, because we need to look at China, because China is now state of the art. A friend of mine went to China, he saw a factory 1 kilometer deep by half a kilometer, it was dark. So you ask somebody else, aren't people working? He said, there are no people, it's fully automated. And something goes wrong, there's a light, and somebody goes, fixes it on a portal. And then the goods are shipped, comes to a truck, loaded on the truck automatically, and the truck goes. Digitization has given greater, you know, growth in certain sectors, particularly in the financial area and retail e-commerce, because retail e-commerce is aggregation of demand and creating one single national market and using data to deliver. I think Alibaba delivers $30 billion of goods in one single day. A sale takes place per day. This is enormous. So the scale difference is very, very high. Many, many companies have implemented efficient processes, and you can see for e-commerce companies, particularly Alibaba, that between the peak and the daily average is 11x. So the capacity to go up 11x in a day is there. And this we never know. Nobody knew it, right? Nobody could do it. Nobody thought about it. But it's happening right now. And the world has changed. Look at this slide here. You find all companies from China and the US, no company from the rest of the world. It's China versus the US. The scale that they can reach allows them to become ecosystem orchestras. That means, because of digitization, you can create your own ecosystem of consumer goods, ecosystem of consumers, payments, money, banks, etc. And these ecosystems feed on each other. So you command the ecosystem, you run the ecosystem, you are in power. And the Chinese companies are seeding the next round of innovation in a massive way compared to the Americans. You go to China and you see what is happening in this area, you find that America is behind, and that's very strange. So digitization is contribute $5 trillion to China's GDP by 2030. So even though debt to GDP is going up, corporate returns have dropped because of keen competition, this is going to add to productivity, so Chinese company will still come on top. So money is shifting from producers to people who command the ecosystem, who are becoming digital monopolies. So India. Now this is India, we're all here. Data cost has plummeted, MSME smartphone has gone up, data consumption has gone up, smartphone cost has come down, right? So we are ahead in the digital payment curve. In the digital payment area for banks, they don't make money, it's all free. UPI did 800 million transactions in 20 months, right? So the banks are getting disintermediated. That means the payment system was what made the banks money, the payment system is getting disintermediated in a big way. And this is happening because of software. India makes 137 billion, this is the old data of software exports, is about 33% of the world, and 137 billion is equal to $200 billion of street value. 60% of global outsourcing comes to India, and the total industry is about $185 billion. 4.5 million people work. America has 6 million people in software, 1 million are Indians. Out of 4.5 million, 2 million work for American companies. Out of 8 million working for American companies, 3 million are Indians. They don't work for you, they work for America. And that changed America. And then, in the top 10 software service companies in the world, by market value, 5 are Indian. Of the top 5, 3 are Indian. TCS is the most valuable, 127 billion. Of the 2 million employees in the top 10 in the world, 1.5 million are Indians. So tech talent and tech ability is available in this country. And now we are seeing the startup boom, which is trying to disrupt the whole of India and the whole of the world. So India has got 40,000 startups creating $140 billion of value. By 2025, we'll have 100,000 startups. So we're going to find new robotics company, new 3D printing companies all come up, fueled by huge amounts of capital. And they're going to change the way manufacturing is done in future. Because capital is flowing there. Capital goes to that area which disrupts legacy. So you could have $1 trillion of value, but capital will flow to those areas which are able to disrupt in anticipation of value and create a high rate of return. So more money comes in, so people sell this short, buy this long, and you see creative destruction. That's the way the markets operate. India has got $50 billion of capital into startups since 1994. Only 5 billion are Indians. 5 billion is Indian money. Indian capitalists are rent seekers. They buy property, and 50 billion has come in. China has put in 10 billion. SoftBank has put in 10 billion. India may become a digital company, digital colony, because the best companies are going to be owned by the Chinese and the Americans. So you're seeing Aadhaar coverage go up, monthly UPI transaction go up, Jandan accounts go up, etc. There are 33 unicorns in India, billion-dollar companies. Do you know that? 33. 25 sunicorns, you could be unicorns by 2020. And by 2025, we'll have 100 unicorns. So India is receiving money, but they're all going to the digital area. It's sad, but this is a reality. The India stack is driving the digital adoption in India, because India stack is the greatest piece of public use software after Linux. And it'll be done by volunteers in Bangalore. And you can see this digitization trend starting, demonetization shocked Indian industry, then we had GSTN which shocked Indian industry, then we had RERA which shocked Indian industry, and then we had that IBC which shocked Indian industry. Now we got no money and they're shocking Indian industry, and Indian industry cannot take any more shocks. Because the capacitive shocks are gone. On top of that, in auto, you have got this EV drive by Niti Aayog, which nobody knows what is going to happen. Then you got this Bharat 6 coming into play with all vehicles changing, and nobody knows what is happening in the market. There is total confusion, and everybody is in a state of shock. Why? Because the rapidity of change, the shock to the system has become too much. The capacity of industry to react to the shock is gone. You just cannot react anymore. Because, you know, you need time to reconfigure, time to move. And why is that? Because we have been behind the curve. And I'll explain that to you as you go along. World-class products are being built in technology. India is going from data poor to data rich. When we become data rich, you're going to have databases wherein you'll run AI algorithms, train machines to think and do things for you. And that's going to be even more terrifying. Look at this benefit that's come in the financial service industry. Bank accounts open in 1 hour compared to 6 days. Mutual funds has gone up by about 4 crore folios in the last 5 years, because it takes 2 minutes to open one because of Aadhaar. To get a SIM card, it takes 4 minutes. So rapidity of change is coming. You're getting credit in a short while because of digitization. Now, what does digitization do to you? One is improving efficiency and finding new source of growth. Now, this is important for you, even though you're in the machine tools industry, capital industry, because the final consumer industry is what is going to impact you, right? Now, if consumer industry buys equipment, they work 3 shifts, demand for you comes down. They change the product, demand for you comes down. So what should you do? You should get into robotics, because robots are the next machine tools. Have you been to the Tesla factory? No? Please go to the Tesla factory. Please take a delegation to China and see the manufacturing units, what is happening there. China is the largest manufacturer of robots. I think the Chinese bought KUKA, that German company, it's a robot company, right? Only FANUC is left. And the Japanese government are not going to sell FANUC to the Chinese. The Chinese are buying up all these robot companies. You go to Tesla. Tesla has got so many robots on the ground, robots in the factory. It is fully automated. They still cannot produce more because they don't have process knowledge. It's still a problem. But if that happens in a large way, the robots will replace machines that are currently in use. Along with 3D printing, that's going to have an impact. So digitization will improve efficiency, reduce costs, and give you new sources of growth. And this you must remember, that If you invest in digitization, you are investing in modernization, system improvement, and now in the world, the smartest one will always win. This year, $2.1 trillion are being spent on technology and related services in the digital world. $2.1 trillion. Where is it being spent? United States, Europe, China, and Japan. And this is for some of this industry. I'm just, you know, I'll go through it because I think it's important to understand, because now the consumer is changing. That the new generation of consumers who are grown up in the digital era, they're grown up with a mobile phone. They're probably getting born with a mobile phone. Now in many parts of the world, they're implanting a chip in your hand to do transaction. They're going to impact a chip here. So you download all the information. There's a famous Swamiji called Nityananda in Bangalore. Now you're all laughing at him. That man is a brilliant man. I interviewed him for 1.5 hours. There's some 2-minute video of mine going, everybody laughs at that. But that man says you can download knowledge. You can download things into your hard disk in the mind. And he actually does something which we don't understand. And the language he speaks is the language that's going to come in the future, because once you have a chip embedded in the mind with signals, you can download a lot of information from the web. Now, is that funny? It is not funny. It will happen. It's happening to machines. Will it happen to human beings? Maybe. There are people who have got cyclops or something, who are putting an antenna on the head to download all the information. Now, how is it going to impact the brain? We don't know. But consumers are changing because consumers want personalization. Now, look at this. Netflix spent $15 billion, is spending $15 billion this year on creating content. More than anybody else. HBO spends $3 billion. $15 billion. They're making a loss, but they're spending $15 billion. And they're personalizing content, so you get what you want without knowing what you want because of your habits. Alibaba, they do 175,000 transactions per second. They have a smart supply chain, is used for forecasting, used for pricing, etc. 95% of all written and spoken queries are handled by chatbots. What are chatbots? Piece of software which can respond to you in human language. It's fully automated. So by smart routing, reduces 30% travel distance. Why do a lot of people make money today? Because of arbitrage, because of inefficiencies in the system, right? Today, our supply chain costs are 14% of GDP. GST will reduce it by 2%. The roads may reduce it by 2%. If trucks travel 30% faster because they can go faster, then the number of trucks on the road will come down. We have got 1 crore trucks in India. We don't need so many. We don't need so many because half of them are parked all the time, or half of them, they only go some 350 kilometers after GST. They used to go 250 kilometers, now 350 kilometers. In America, they go 600 kilometers a day. Alibaba uses user profiles to lend. This is in Alipay. This is Uber, which leverages ride data to help government with urban mobility planning. This is a precursor to getting autonomous cars. When autonomous cars come, the new generation will stop owning cars. Why should you own a car? 90% of the time the car is parked. 10% of real estate in America is for parking. I mean, you can go to Zoom car and take a Bentley and drive it for 2 days, and you can't drive anywhere in Bangalore. Somebody will bash you up, right? So if you get a car which is autonomous, which is available to you for use, you rather use it than buy a car. If people stop buying cars, what happened to industry? The world makes 90 million four-wheelers plus per year. It's a $2 trillion industry. $2 trillion every year, 90 million cars and, you know, trucks, etc. If that shrinks, what happens to the industry? Implant chip that uses that allows user to maintain digital verification. You can see here on the hand there's a chip which is implanted for payments. Discuss Lab is a machine learned data refinery for predictive intelligence over geospatial data. That means satellites, weather, pricing, they take data from the ground and they're able to give you micro level predictive analysis for agriculture and for, you know, trading or whatever it is. Adidas, What has Adidas done? Adidas has taken their shoe factory from China and put into Germany, fully automated with robotics. What are the problem till now? The robots did not have dexterity in their hands because their fingers are dexterous. We can move it all around the place and do everything. Now the robots have got that. So they can do electronic assembly, which required lines of Chinese women. I don't know what will happen in India, but the Chinese had 1 million, Foxconn had 1 million women doing the assembly of Apple phones. 4 years back, they asked for more money. 50,000 of them got replaced by robots. And every year, 50,000 are getting replaced by robots. Because robots don't ask for a raise. No work-life balance. They work 24 hours. Right? Well, you're all capitalists, I'm sure. But you know, and Adidas has done that. They reduced the production to market time from 2 months to under 2 weeks. The shoes got better, much, much better. And it's because of 3D printing, robotic arms, computerized knitting. So the computer is the new machine tool. The robo is the new machine tool with intelligence. Gray Orange is a company in India which has built a complete in-house, in-warehouse automation platform using robots to move things in a warehouse. Now, how the robo moves and what it does and recognition is a great piece of hardware. Additive manufacturing has transcended traditional metallurgical mechanical application with new biochemical innovations. Human organs are getting printed, growing in petri labs. They're trying to make heart walls. They're trying to make blood vessels. Is it going to succeed? Yeah. It's going to succeed. Maybe when? Maybe 2 years, 3 years, 4 years. Are they going to be good enough to use? Maybe 5 years. So you can get all your organs replaced. So you can keep drinking single malt without feeling the impact. Nanoparticle jetting technology to 3D printing using combination of metals and ceramics. Now you know that metals and ceramics don't work together, but if you break it up into nanoparticles and start beating them to powder, you can do many things, right? Now even the chip technology is changing from silicon to other material. And you can see these use cases, what is happening. Boston Dynamics has created a robo that can run. They can do a backflip and land on the feet. You must see the video. It will stand, do a backflip and land on his feet. It's incredible. And he can run as fast as the cheetah, 65 kilometers an hour. And then it can use handles to lift, because you know, robots could not lift. They can lift goods, keep it here, stack, do everything else. And you can see that handles objects, climb stairs, will operate in homes, outdoors. This is a business opportunity. But you have to change. Designer babies. We want some leaders to be eternal. We have a 95-year-old leader who wants to be eternal. Maybe you can recreate him. The others who are 74, 75, who want to rule over us for a long time, maybe we need them. But you can see, because of CRISPR technology, you can go edit your DNA. From your DNA, you can remove something and put something else to get you whatever you want. Because the DNA is the machine language to build, right? Initiative to improve internet access as enables PERT, because what is driving this is that all human beings are coming on one platform where full knowledge is available, consumer, you know, interaction is available, you can do business, you can get enterprise, you can get everything else, a lot of it free, asynchronously, and the tyranny of distance is coming down. OYO, you know what OYO has done, 575,000 hotel rooms. So now Airbnb has got all apartments which are vacant as houses for you to stay. Hotels are getting impacted. Ola has digitized the ecosystem at scale. Why has car buying come down? Partially because Ola cut down the rates. So drivers are not making money, they stop buying cars. Right? They used to buy, Ola, Uber used to buy maybe 200, 250,000 cars every year for the last 3-4 years. Now it's come down to 50,000. And more Ola, Uber drives are there, more and more people will stop buying cars. Because they do saturation marketing. If things are available every time, you don't need something else. Clean mobility. So you're seeing multimodal transport for human beings coming through a company called Yulu. Right, Yulu is in Bangalore, by which they have tracked entire networks to find out where people park, where people go, when do they travel, how do they travel, everything else to give last minute connectivity. It's all on a sharing basis. All on a sharing basis. So same vehicle goes 5 times for maybe 5 people. And then you have Ather coming with that electric vehicle in Bangalore. And some people are creating a new bank on top of a bank. Better Place is a platform for blue-collar workers. So blue-collar work is getting consolidated. Score Data is a company that does, you know, big data analytics, creating a platform to do predictive analysis. Deep Tech. Google is using AI to predict lung cancer through 3D volumetric modeling. So what are they doing? They're trying to check up your lungs by looking at the volume and see how the volume shrinks because of cancer, and then see how to model it to find out on people who may be about to get cancer whether the probability cancer is there. It detected 5% more cancer cases. Verge automates drug discovery process using AI to map genes related to specific diseases. 30% of drugs don't agree with you because of DNA. Now you're going to get DNA designer drugs. You fall ill, they take a piece of a DNA, send it to the cloud, and then they come back and tell you, you must take this drug, and you can take the drug, you become better. Indian companies, there's a machine learning company in Bangalore, which has 5 major high-volume screening processes using blood smears, urine, semen, etc., to give you pathological reports. So all the pathological labs. So you go take a blood, take a photograph, send it, goes to the cloud, compares, report comes in 10 minutes. You need somebody to sign because, you know, that's a law. Bugworks is finding something in Bangalore for, you know, the superbugs. Airbnb uses neural networks to personalize search. So less houses are going to be built because you don't need them anymore. Because young people may not buy houses, they may go stay in a different house every month. There's enough capacity. Now, companies in music and digitization using machine learning to create weekly personalized playlist. So our mind is sought to be controlled by all these people. Because we are digital data. Our digital persona is available. So we are not human beings, we are a piece of data. We are a piece of data which shows habit, which shows what we do, how we think, how we behave. Because everything is a pattern. Because there is not many people are beyond normal sigma. Everything comes into a pattern. You find enough cases, you get the pattern. For example, we tied up with IBM Watson for oncology in Manipal Hospital. They had 50,000 cases, and we used to send our doctor's diagnosis there. Of course, we are right 98.5% of the time. But with 450,000 cases, they could get 90% of all cases in the world. Why? Because there are not so many unique cases, right? Everything is a pattern. Bloomberg utilizes machine learning to generate social media sentiment. See how the world is changing. Stock market movements happen because of social media. Why? Through social media, you can find out who is thinking, who is doing what, who is sending messages, and track that and input it by an algorithm into stock market trading, and you get something else. Because trading and market activity is based upon greed and fear. Both are emotions. ZenDrive uses smartphone sensors to measure and improve driving behavior. Just by a smartphone, when you drive, they can track what you do and do many things. Houndify allows integration of voice and conversational AI. Texteco deciphers meaningful pattern to communicate. So marketing is going to be very different tomorrow compared to what it is. See, today there are lots of enterprises. If enterprises shrink and become fewer, that means repeat buying is not there. Right? So the future is fluid and limited only by your imagination. So digitization is rewriting. Now, what is happening in India? Let me take a while. There's a huge amount of capital coming in to drive innovation at the edge. And this is impacting consumers directly, because consumers are changing behavior. A new generation of buyers is coming up who have got money. And the power of the mobile phone is giving more power to the consumer. And now that is creating new disruptions, because the quantum of stock in the system may come down. And it is changing the way businesses behave. Now the drive for electric vehicles will change the car industry and the truck industry in the next 5 to 7 years dramatically. All right? And then the utility industry will be changed when we have 125,000, 175,000 megawatts of alternate energy. In June of this year, for the first time in 200 years, the UK ran with alternate energy with no coal being burnt. Coal is gone. Right? Germany uses 30% of its energy by wind and solar, and gas, of course. So what happens to oil? If lesser cars are purchased, what happens to oil? If less oil is consumed, what happened in the Middle East? If less oil is consumed, what happened to the shipping? What happens to the pipelines? What happened to the petrol bunks? What happens to insurance, car insurance, if there's more autonomous cars? What happens to life insurance, accident insurance, if accidents come down? So the chain of things that happen, we don't know what is going to happen, but it's happening. And the impact is being felt rather dramatically, and there'll be a wave of consolidation in the industry that is happening in very different ways. So let me talk about the Indian economy. India's GDP today is $2.73 trillion. PPP is $11.4 trillion. We will be $5 trillion despite all this slowdown. I'll explain why the slowdown is my theory. And we could be $10 trillion, except the rupee dollar rate is a key factor. Otherwise, we'll grow 7.5-8% and 3.5% inflation, 11.5-12%. If you add it up, you know, it's achievable. But will we grow 8%? In 1991, when we opened up, we were $275 billion. In 2019, March, we are $2.73 trillion. We have grown at 8.6% a year in dollar term for 28 years. Delhi doesn't look at data. That's why there's not, people are not talking, but that is the data. So we could grow at that fast pace. What is driving the growth? Consumption and investment. 70% of India is consumption, 30% is investment. Investment has come down in the last 3 to 4 years. Primarily because there's excess capacity, because they were built up with the bank loans, and we know with IBC, a lot of things are happening. We know why they were all built, etc., etc., etc. Now, will consumption keep rising? Consumption rises based upon jobs and people's income. Now, are people's income going up? Inflation is down, like you said, sir. Inflation is down. Why is inflation down? An economist told me that money supply got squeezed by demonetization. So money supply to GDP has come down. And the velocity of increase in money supply has come down. And that's the biggest factor for the last 4 years, the last three and a half years for inflation to come down. And government borrowing also came down. And then black money generation has come down. Because the real estate after demonetization, if black money was 30%, it's come down to 20%. For traders, it is a 30%, it's come down to 10%. And people are scared because you can track where the money is. So money circulation has come down. So even though total quantum of money has gone up, I think it's 21 lakh crores or whatever it is today, the percent of GDP, it has come down. I think that compared to what it was at one point of time. That's what the economists say. Then what happened? In September, I think, of last year, the IL&FS crisis blew up. At the time the IL&FS crisis blew up, a lot of the consumer credit was coming through the NBFCs. And the NBFCs were lending to real estate companies, they were lending to supply chain companies, automobile dealers, etc. They're lending to consumers, and they're lending to small businesses, because the banks were not lending too much. A latest report says 40% of incremental consumer lending came through NBFCs in the last financial year. 40%. So banks are not the major lenders. The NBFCs are major lenders. All right? Because it has gone up tremendously. Now, when the IL&FS crisis hit. The first impact were the mutual funds, because they were lending money. Because people were going to mutual funds because they're collecting money. They were lending money through CPs or to short-term lending of 90 days. They stopped because they had to take a hit for IL&FS. But IL&FS was using short-term money for building roads. It's crazy, but it's happening. So when they got hit, they took a write-off. Then all mutual funds stopped lending more money. They started calling back the money. And mutual fund lending is 25% of the total lending to NBFCs. The NBFCs asset base is 24 lakh crores. The total bank lending is 97 lakh crores. So it is significant. So when the NBFCs started calling the money back, it means money going into the market, maybe 3 to 5 lakhs crores a year stopped, 50,000, 60,000 crores a month, right? And then they called the money back, paid back the money. It went into maybe bank deposits. So further lending stopped, the money came back, and there is a crunch in the market. So the dealers who stocked cars, they couldn't stock anymore because the financing for the cars came down. And then people stopped buying. 10%, 15% consumers stopped buying because there's no money to give them credit. It won't work because banks may give you credit. But today in the dealer shop with the NBFC guy who went and gave you credit immediately, the banks will make you run around, do this, do that, give me this, give me that, right? In the NBFC, they used to see your face and give you the vehicle. Say 25% down, show me Aadhaar card and take the vehicle. Now that has come down. They're not lending anymore. So money is gone out of the system. And there's a gap in the system. And that's why the dealers are shutting down. Because if you look at cars, think about it. You know, we sell 28 lakhs cars a year in India. About 35 lakh cars are made and they export 700,000, 28 lakh cars, right? Who buys the car? Middle class with borrowing, correct? Because they pay in installment, 80-90% borrowing. Not many put a cash down because it's dumb to put a cash down. You can use the money for something else, right? That means out of 137 crore people is something like about maybe, let's say, 28 crore families. 28 into 5, maybe 4.5, 28 crore families. Out of 28 crore families, maybe 5 crore families or 6 crore families are the one who buy cars. They can afford to buy cars. Am I right? 6 into 5, 30 crore people. Correct? That's your market. Others can't buy. They may buy, but very rare. Okay? Out of this 6 crore families, you know, maybe they used to buy a car, they used to replace a car. If 10% of the people who buy a car don't buy a car because there's no money in the market, or they're not getting credit, the car crashes down by 10%. That's point number one. Point number two, because of the BS6, people read newspapers. They're pretty smart. They're waiting for the new model. Because I buy something now, then I can't sell it later in 1st April. And the Supreme Court has said no more change. Correct? That's the point number two. And the third thing which is happening is, for two-wheelers, they drive towards electric vehicles and others. People are very confused. So consumer financing has come down, consumption has come down, and in real estate, there are many marginal people. They got struck by RERA. They got struck by the fact that, you know, high-priced apartments are not being bought. Because who bought the high-priced apartment? People who had surplus money for investment. Not everything was done by the consumer, correct? They said it'll go up. For the last 3-4 years, real estate has not gone up. So speculators are not putting money. And for the last 3-4 years, bribe money in Delhi has come down. Bribe money has come down. So real estate in Noida, in Gurgaon has come down. Because where did the money go? It went into real estate. It's all come down. Because you go to the UPA too, you could see that, no, price is going up, lot of real estate. Where did the money come from? It's all cash, gone. Correct? So real estate also is seeing a decline in construction. And the jobs have come down in that area. Many of the smaller companies are shutting down. So real estate is impacted. Consumer is impacted. Auto is impacted. And these are major sectors. And you had, like you told me, three, four years of boom with 30%. Can't be good forever. So now industry has to wait for liquidity to come back to the market. Government is trying to do something. It will take some time. So last quarter of last year, GDP grew by 5.8%. First quarter, SBI says will be 5.6%. They'll announce this month end. This quarter also is gone, maybe 5.2-5.3%. And unless money comes back by September, in the festival season, it could go up to maybe 6%. And then the last quarter of this year, the Kharif crop comes into being, some money come, there could be an uptick. So this year we're not going to grow more than 6%. And the liquidity doesn't improve, the cycle doesn't start again. Because next year we're going to have new vehicles come, BS6 vehicle come, the fuel has to be there. There could be confusion for the first 3 or 4 months. So next year too, the growth could be impacted for the first quarter. So maybe second quarter of next year, we could come back to near normal, what normal being maybe the September quarter of last year. So there is a problem. Everybody is confused. And politically, we are in a mess because in September, when this ILFS blew up, our finance minister was not doing well. Right? And then October, November, December, they tried to do something, but the election fever is going on. Then January, February, March, the election started, campaigning started, nothing happened, government is not working. Right? Then we had the results in May, then we had parliament, new budget, new finance minister, a bit of a mess. Then we had Kashmir. So entire political attention has gone to all these items. Now parliament is closed, budgets are over. You are seeing some kind of talk and some kind of action and some kind of worry coming. And finally, Prime Minister Modi said he's not going to go after people who are wealth creators and, you know, right kind of noises are being made. So consumer finance not being available, money being pulled from the market, and then lack of political action, government which did not take decisions or didn't anticipate, the Reserve Bank of India which kept interest rates very high, all that has come together to create this situation. And at the root of it all is the kind of shocks industry got for the last 4 years. Like I said, demonetization, then you had GST, then you had IBC, then you had the RERA, then you had this BS6, particularly for your industry. Now all that has come together and the impact of that is felt here. And that's why you're feeling a slowdown. And when a slowdown happens, capital goods industry gets hit the most. So what should you do? One, you must create flexible organizations to respond to the market. In your association, have a chief economist who can possibly advise you how the economy is going to go and do some predictions. Second, get into robotics and new forms of manufacturing. See how the world is going. Go to China, go to Tesla, go to cutting-edge manufacturers, see what is happening. Right? And third, reorient your organizational structure. Okay? To put in more money into R&D, a little bit more, and get a few people who can talk about trends and advise you, and lower your fixed cost. Right? Lower your fixed cost. And fourth, try to export more. Invest more money in exporting in other parts of the world where you have, may have a competitive advantage. South America comes to mind, right? Maybe Southeast Asia comes to mind, where people are still spending money buying some machines and doing things because they're way behind. Now, the world has changed. Now, all these, are they short-term, long-term measures? They're short-term measures. In the long term, there's going to be new ways of manufacturing for which all of us have to get prepared. Manufacturing will remain. It's not going to go away. We need goods, we need services. But the way things are manufactured will change. The life of the manufactured good will change. The quantum of the manufactured good will change. Quantum is going to come down. So broad consumption trends will come down because usage of assets will go up. When there's aggregation of demand and easier discovery, usage of assets will go up. And that usage of assets going up means lesser capital assets are required. Right? Any questions? No, it's been happening for some time. If you think government has got thinking, you're mistaken. I wish government had more thinking. Let me tell you, let me make a statement. Government of India does not have the capacity or the capability to manage a fast-growing economy in an extremely complex world. They're not invested enough. They're not abreast of trends. They're behind the curve. Because India is a very, very complex country. There are 300 million people who are on par with the rest of the world. Another 300 million people who want to be where the first 300 million are, and the rest are way behind. Now you've got to cater to all of them, take on the future, and invest for the future, and get ready and compete with the big beast, China. It's a very, very difficult task. You've got to think and work at different levels, which unfortunately requires capacity in the government to get policies, to move fast, to remove impediments to business, understand what is happening. For example, the RBI makes a fortnightly statistical analysis of bank deposits and bank lending, but they don't do it for NBFCs. They don't do it for mutual funds. Savings in mutual funds are going up. Every year, 5 to 6 lakh crores is coming there. They're not tracking it. They're not tracking lending by NBFCs. So they're saying the system liquidity. RBI governor says the system liquidity. The DFS system liquidity. Yeah, the liquidity. But the banks are not lending. Lending is by NBFCs. NBFCs don't have liquidity. So where is liquidity?
Indirect tax revolution caused by GST is yet to mature, and Government of India is bringing a new direct state tax code. Is it not too much for a nation like India to digest so many reforms?
See, the direct tax code hopefully will reduce tax terrorism. Because tax terrorism now, you know, after I wrote that article and we spoke up on TV, we sent a 6-point program to government. 1 point has been done. That means the threshold for appeals has gone up. To appeal to High Court has gone to 1 crore from 50 lakhs, to Supreme Court 2 crores from 1 crore, to Tribunal from 20 lakhs has gone to 50 lakhs. So smaller cases will go away. Now they're looking at how to isolate, remove tax terrorism, because they're very concerned. I think that will improve. And the new tax code will reduce many of the big things that have happened. Hopefully life could be better. There is hope, because I think Prime Minister Modi is very intent on making it happen. So the new tax code will be good. That will be good. It will reduce your taxes too, hopefully, and improve many other things. Improve compliance, improve this thing. The GST's problem is, the GST is an over-engineered product. Filing is very difficult. It's not because of technology. Infosys did a fabulous job. It's because the design of that was get to bureaucrats, and the bureaucrat made it so complicated because they give me this, give me that, give me that. They never thought of users. And because of that, you know, because they don't want to make it simple. If they make it simple, their power is gone. That's why the state government officers want power, central government, everybody wants power. Now I hear to get refunds, they're asking for some things, right? Some people told me, to get a refund, you go meet them, they said, baat karenge. So anywhere there's a discretion in the hands of officials. So there's a tussle between the political leaders and these people about what has to be done. That's why we need more people from industry to stand up and to talk and to point out and to work to do well. Because I believe our political leaders want good things for us. But execution is by the bureaucracy. And their mindset has not changed. They're still in the control era. Yes, sir.
So one more question. By Mr. K. L. Adu. Is there a case for complete abolition of Indian income tax?
No. I keep getting the stupid suggestion there. Let me tell you why. The total income tax is 6 lakh crores. 6 lakh crores on 1 crore, 90 lakh crores is maybe 3.25% of GDP. What are you going to replace it with? Right? 12 lakh crores is the total income tax and corporate tax. What are you going to replace with? The big hole. You can't make a transaction tax. You'll never get that money. All that is lousy calculations. It's not going to work. See, the income tax has to be at reasonable levels because it is on income that you want. Now, you can't tax consumption out of existence. Correct? Because people only when people buy more, volumes go up, you become a big economy, etc. For that, costs have to come down. In fact, the average tax after GST has come down by 3%. Average tax has come down by 3%. FMCG companies are showing a 3% reduction in the total tax paid. They've seen an increase in margins, but now demand has come down. That's a problem. million people on the internet. And you must remember, India, there are only 300 million consumers. Out of 1.37 billion people in India, maybe 300 billion have about $4,000 of income, per capita income. That's about 1.2 trillion. And the balance maybe having $1,100. So whatever happens is this market. So you've got to be careful that not everything. If today the janta is not crying because they're okay, only this 10, 20 million people are crying about lack of growth. And I'll explain to you as you go along. Now what is happening on the world is that digital platforms with strong network impacts are coming together and changing the way business is done. The traditional product and services and business is now tempering down. So the new wave of business is coming up because of the improvement in connectivity, reduction in the rates, and reduction in cloud storage costs. Digital penetration has gone up to an all-time high, so I think platforms have changed. Now you can see this transaction by payment channels, online and buy buttons, and everything else, 60% digital. How does it matter to you? Because it matters to the consumer industries and it comes back to you. Because you are an input to the consumer industry since you sell capital goods. Now, look at this chart. The impact you have today is the speed of adoption is very, very high. Pokemon went to 50 million users in 19 days. Twitter took 2 years. Jio has got 340 million users in about 10 quarters. That is unbelievable. The pace of change is so rapid that we are not able to adjust. The early movers dominate the market. I'm giving you all this data to understand the impact on the macro scale. Then we'll come to the micro scale. Look at 2017. The biggest, most valuable companies are Apple, Alphabet, Microsoft, Amazon, Facebook, etc. None of them is a manufacturing company. So this is a digital impact. The winners look vulnerable till they don't. Nobody is vulnerable. I mean, nobody is beyond being vulnerable. Everybody is vulnerable, and it's going to impact people more because the time for change is very less. How is our enterprises digitizing? The enterprise are digitizing because of data generation, because data acquisition has become very important to consumers. Access costs are coming down. And today, India consumes 11 GB of data per user per month. America consumes 2.85 GB of data. We get unlimited data for $1.50. For 100 rupees, you get unlimited data from Jio. Now that is changing everything. Cloud storage costs are plummeted. Look at the chart. You're still lucky. You're getting 80-85% of the value you probably got 5 years ago. Look at this cloud, okay? Moore's law is dead. The computing power is going up primarily because of the increase in powers to the GPUs, and now we're going to have what is called quantum computing, which will accelerate computing power by 5x. And if computing power goes up by 5x, robots will take over. The big thing about this revolution is that you have machines with intelligence. Machines who can use data to have intelligence for repeat work situations, right? In all other earlier disruptions, you never had machines with so much of intelligence. Today, they required human beings. Today, they don't require human beings for many activities. Leap in algorithmic techniques. Today, virtual recognition has come to something like 98%. So the machine can take your image and do computer vision, track it with the database, and come out instantaneously. In China, there are millions of cameras all over the place, so anybody going on the street is known to people who are tracking them instantaneously, and it recognizes everybody. And even if you look at voice recognition, that is taken over, it's 95%. So you can recognize anybody through a database based upon his voice. So you make a call, you know exactly who that is. So what does it mean for the enterprise? Now for enterprises, you need deep learning to train machines to come out with solutions. Recommendation engines for consumers to tell you what to buy, what to do. Predictive analysis to look at market trends. Now, look at a car manufacturer, all right? How do the car manufacturer sell? He gets all the components, he keeps it all together, assembles it, sells it to dealers, and then the dealers sell. Today, the entire system is automated. When the consumer buys, the entire thing is upgraded in the database, and the database flows to the manufacturer. The manufacturer sends the component to supplier. Supplier sends the goods the next day, and you have short runs in the assembly line, and the car can be reconfigured. Now the next stage is, you want to get a car done, you go to the portal, and a designer in Bangalore will sit down with you and design a car. You press a button, next door, by 3D printing, you are able to get a car in 24 hours. What happens to supply chain? What happens to machine tools? What happens to all the nice stuff that we're used to? Is it a reality? Well, 3D printing has happened for cars, for rocket engines, it's happened for houses, it's happened for the human skull, it's happened for the human bones, it's happened for blood vessels, it's happened for parts of a liver in Bangalore, many other things. So this is exponential change that's going to come, but is it going to impact people? Over a period of time, but it impacts people at the edge. When things impact at the edge, the value for the entire sector drops. So you need natural language generation, because that helps the entire supply chain come down, and you're going to have evidence-based decision making. Now this is a key slide to show you the convergence of technology across many areas. Big data, analytics, IoT, AI, quantum computing is all coming together in a shorter period of time, because the cycles earlier were long, so you could reconfigure. Now the cycles are very short. When cycles are very short, at the market, the economies are flush with money, not in India though, we're short of money here, then everything gets impacted very rapidly. Labor productivity has been stagnating for many years. I'm taking the advanced countries because we are still not there. And now labor productivity has been stagnating primarily because machines have come to be ubiquitous, and people are using the machines, but they're not seeing an increase in productivity. So you need a quantum jump in computing power, in AI, to bring back labor productivity to reduce costs, because costs are going up. Now this is a very dense chart, just look at it. So digitization is going to impact all industries. You can see the industries at the bottom: mining, real estate, agriculture, transportation, utilities, construction, every other industries, and in very different ways. So the value in all those industries is going to shrink. Combined effect of digitization industry, the consumer industry is impacted the most, and the great value and the jobs are going to come down. This is by a survey, and then automotive, where you are involved, there the jobs may not go up, may not come down, may remain the same, but then there's going to be great impact. Now you know that EV vehicle has got only 20 moving parts, it's an electric motor, and then a IC engine has got 2,000 moving parts. A EV costs only $1,500 a year to maintain in the US, whereas an IC costs $10,500. And last year, the world made 1.5 million EV vehicles, this year maybe 2 million, and China is driving it. And EVs can run for 500,000 kilometers without dying. Now you make money because the car dies, because it's all moving parts. When you have an electric motor run with autonomously, then you are in a different world altogether. You can see all these industries which are going to get impacted. They're going to impact the utility industry, is going to impact the logistic industry, the aviation industry, etc. Return on industry by technology, if you look at this, the leaders will always make more money, and the delta between the leaders and the followers is going to expand, because those who innovate are the ones who are going to make more money. So you've got to be ahead of the curve. You've got to be faster than anybody else. And now we are seeing data right from 2006, how leaders are getting far ahead of followers. How has design changed China? China enjoys a scale advantage, because we need to look at China, because China is now state of the art. A friend of mine went to China, he saw a factory 1 kilometer deep by half a kilometer, it was dark. So you ask somebody else, aren't people working? He said, there are no people, it's fully automated. And something goes wrong, there's a light, and somebody goes, fixes it on a portal, and then the goods are shipped, comes to a truck, loaded on the truck automatically, and the truck goes. Digitization has given greater, you know, growth in certain sectors, particularly in the financial area and retail e-commerce, because retail e-commerce is aggregation of demand and creating one single national market and using data to deliver. I think Alibaba delivers $30 billion of goods in one single day. A sale takes place per day. This is enormous, so the scale difference is very, very high. Many, many companies have implemented efficient processes, and you can see for e-commerce companies, particularly Alibaba, that between the peak and the daily average is 11x. But the capacity to go up 11x in a day is there. And this we never know. Nobody knew it, right? Nobody could do it. Nobody thought about it. But it's happening right now. And the world has changed. Look at this slide here. You find all companies from China and the US, no company from the rest of the world. It's China versus the US. The scale that they can reach allows them to become ecosystem orchestras. That means, because of digitization, you can create your own ecosystem of consumer goods, ecosystem of consumers, payments, money, banks, etc. And these ecosystems feed on each other. So you command the ecosystem, you run the ecosystem, you are in power. And the Chinese companies are seeding the next round of innovation in a massive way compared to the Americans. You go to China and you see what is happening in this area, you find that America is behind, and that's very strange. So digitization is contribute $5 trillion to China's GDP by 2030. So even though debt to GDP is going up, corporate returns have dropped because of keen competition, this is going to add to productivity, so a Chinese company will still come on top. So money is shifting from producers to people who command the ecosystem who are becoming digital monopolies. So India. Now this is India, we're all here. Data cost has plummeted. MSME smartphone has gone up, data consumption has gone up, smartphone cost has come down, right? So we are ahead in the digital payment curve. In the digital payment area for banks, they don't make money, it's all free. UPI did 800 million transactions in 20 months, right? So the banks are getting disintermediated. That means the payment system was what made the banks money, the payment system is getting disintermediated in a big way. And this is happening because of software. India makes $137 billion, this is old data of software exports, is about 33% of the world, and $137 billion is equal to $200 billion of street value. 60% of global outsourcing comes to India, and the total industry is about $185 billion. 4.5 million people work. America has 6 million people in software, 1 million are Indians. Out of 4.5 million, 2 million work for American companies. Out of 8 million working for American companies, 3 million are Indians. They don't work for you, they work for America. And that changed America. And then in the top 10 software service companies in the world, by market value, 5 are Indian. Of the top 5, 3 are Indian. TCS is the most valuable, $127 billion. Of the 2 million employees in the top 10 in the world, 1.5 million are Indians. So tech talent and tech ability is available in this country. And now we are seeing the startup boom, which is trying to disrupt the whole of India and the whole of the world. So India has got 40,000 startups creating $140 billion of value. By 2025, we'll have 100,000 startups. So we're going to find new robotics company, new 3D printing companies all come up, fueled by huge amounts of capital. And they're going to change the way manufacturing is done in future. Because capital is flowing there. Capital goes to that area which disrupts legacy. So you could have $1 trillion of value, but capital will flow to those areas which are able to disrupt in anticipation of value and create a high rate of return. So more money comes in, so people sell this short, buy this long, and you see creative destruction. That's the way the markets operate. India has got $50 billion of capital into startups since 1994. Only 5 billion are Indians. 5 billion is Indian money. Indian capitalists are rent seekers. They buy property, and $50 billion has come in. China has put in $10 billion. SoftBank is putting $10 billion. India may become a digital company, digital colony, because the best companies are going to be owned by the Chinese and the Americans. So you're seeing Aadhaar coverage go up, monthly UPI transaction go up, Jandan accounts go up, etc. There are 33 unicorns in India, $1 billion companies. Do you know that? 33. 25 sunicorns, you could be unicorns by 2020. And by 2025, we'll have 100 unicorns. So India is receiving money, but they're all going to the digital area. It's sad, but this is a reality. The India stack is driving the digital adoption in India, because India stack is the greatest piece of public use software after Linux. And it'll be done by volunteers in Bangalore. And you can see this digitization trend starting, demonetization shocked Indian industry, Then we had GSTN, which shocked Indian industry. Then we had RERA, which shocked Indian industry. And then we had that IBC, which shocked Indian industry. Now we got no money and they're shocking Indian industry. And Indian industry cannot take any more shocks, because the capacitive shocks are gone. On top of that, in auto, you have got this EV drive by Niti Aayog, which nobody knows what is going to happen. Then you got this Bharat 6 coming into play with all vehicles changing, and nobody knows what is happening in the market. There is total confusion, and everybody is in a state of shock. Why? Because the rapidity of change, the shock to the system has become too much. The capacity of industry to react to the shock is gone. You just cannot react anymore. Because, you know, you need time to reconfigure, time to move. And why is that? Because we have been behind the curve. And I'll explain that to you as you go along. World-class products are being built in technology. India is going from data poor to data rich. When we become data rich, you don't have databases wherein you'll run AI algorithms, train machines to think and do things for you. And that's going to be even more terrifying. Look at this benefit that's come in the financial service industry. Bank accounts open in 1 hour compared to 6 days. Mutual funds has gone up by about 4 crores folios in the last 5 years, because it takes 2 minutes to open one because of Aadhaar. To get a SIM card, it takes 4 minutes. So the rapidity of change is coming. You're getting credit in a short while because of digitization. Now, what does digitization do to you? One is improving efficiency and finding new source of growth. Now, this is important for you, even though you're in the machine tools industry, capital industry, because the final consumer industry is what is going to impact you, right? Now, if consumer industry buys equipment, they work 3 shifts, demand for you comes down. They change the product, demand for you comes down. So what should you do? You should get into robotics, because robots are the next machine tools. Have you been to the Tesla factory? No? Please go to the Tesla factory. Please take a delegation to China and see the manufacturing units, what is happening there. China is the largest manufacturer of robots. I think the Chinese bought KUKA, that German company, it's a robot company, right? Only FANUC is left. And the Japanese government are not going to sell FANUC to the Chinese. The Chinese are buying up all these robot companies. You go to Tesla. Tesla has got so many robots on the ground, robots in the factory. It is fully automated. They still cannot produce more because they don't have process knowledge. It's still a problem. But if that happens in a large way, the robots will replace machines that are currently in use. Along with 3D printing, that's going to have an impact. So digitization will improve efficiency, reduce costs, and give you new sources of growth. And this you must remember, that if you invest in digitization, you are investing in modernization, system improvement, and now in the world, the smartest one will always win. This year, $2.1 trillion are being spent on technology and related services in the digital world. $2.1 trillion. Where is it being spent? United States, Europe, China, and Japan. And this is for some of this industry. I'm just, you know, I'll go through it because I think it's important to understand, because now the consumer is changing. That the new generation of consumers who are grown up with the digital era, they're grown up with a mobile phone. They're probably getting born with a mobile phone. Now in many parts of the world, they're implanting a chip in your hand to do transaction. They're going to impact a chip here. So you download all the information. There's a famous Swamiji called Nityananda in Bangalore. Now you're all laughing at him. That man is a brilliant man. I interviewed him for 1.5 hours. There's some 2-minute video of mine going, everybody laughs at that. But that man says you can download knowledge. You can download things into your hard disk in the mind. And he actually does something which we don't understand. And the language he speaks is the language that's going to come in the future, because once you have a chip embedded in the mind with signals, you can download a lot of information from the web. Now, is that funny? It is not funny. It will happen. It's happening to machines. Will it happen to human beings? Maybe. There are people who have got, they got cyclops or something, who are putting an antenna on their head to get download all the information. Now, how is it going to impact the brain? We don't know. But consumers are changing, because consumers want personalization. Now, look at this. Netflix spent $15 billion, is spending $15 billion this year on creating content. More than anybody else. HBO spends $3 billion. 15 billion. They're making a loss, but they're spending 15 billion, and they're personalizing content, so you get what you want without knowing what you want because of your habits. Alibaba, they do 175,000 transactions per second. They have a smart supply chain, is used for forecasting, used for pricing, etc. 95% of all written and spoken queries are handled by chatbots. What are chatbots? Piece of software which can respond to you in human language. It's fully automated. So by smart routing, reduces 30% travel distance. Why do a lot of people make money today? Because of arbitrage, because of inefficiencies in the system, right? Today, our supply chain costs are 14% of GDP. GST will reduce it by 2%. The roads may reduce it by 2%. If trucks travel 30% faster because they can go faster, then the number of trucks on the road will come down. We have got 1 crore trucks in India. We don't need so many. We don't need so many. Because half of them are parked all the time, or half of them, they only go some 350 kilometers after GST. They used to go 250 kilometers, now 350 kilometers. In America, they go 600 kilometers a day. Alibaba uses user profiles to lend. This is in Alipay. This is Uber, which leverages ride data to help government with urban mobility planning. This is a precursor to getting autonomous cars. When autonomous cars come, the new generation will stop owning cars. Why should you own a car? 90% of the time the car is parked. 10% of real estate in America is for parking. I mean, you can go to Zoom car and take a Bentley and drive it for 2 days, and you can't drive anywhere in Bangalore. Somebody will bash you up, right? So if you get a car which is autonomous, which is available to you for use, you rather use it than buy a car. If people stop buying cars, what happened to industry? The world makes 90 million four-wheelers plus per year. It's a $2 trillion industry. $2 trillion every year, 90 million cars and, you know, trucks, etc. If that shrinks, what happens to the industry? Implant chip that uses, that allows user to maintain digital verification. You can see here, on the hand, there's a chip which is implanted for payments. Discourse Lab is a machine learned data refinery for predictive intelligence over geospatial data. That means satellites, weather, pricing, they take data from the ground and they're able to give you micro level predictive analysis for agriculture and for, you know, trading or whatever it is. Adidas. What has Adidas done? Adidas has taken their shoe factory from China and put into Germany, fully automated with robotics. What are the problem till now? The robots did not have dexterity in their hands because their fingers are dexterous. We can move it all around the place and do everything. Now the robots have got that. So they can do electronic assembly, which required lines of Chinese women. I don't know what will happen in India, but the Chinese had 1 million, Foxconn had 1 million women doing the assembly of Apple phones. 4 years back, they asked for more money. 50,000 of them got replaced by robots. And every year, 50,000 are getting replaced by robots. Because robots don't ask for a raise. No work-life balance. They work 24 hours. Right? Well, you're all capitalists, I'm sure. But you know, and Adidas has done that. They reduced the production to market time from 2 months to under 2 weeks. The shoes got better, much, much better. And it's because of 3D printing, robotic arms, computerized knitting. So the computer is the new machine tool. The robo is the new machine tool with intelligence. Gray Orange is a company in India which has built a complete in-house, in-warehouse automation platform using robots to move things in a warehouse. Now, how the robo moves and what it does and recognition is a great piece of hardware. Additive manufacturing has transcended traditional metallurgical mechanical application with new biochemical innovations. Human organs are getting printed, growing in petri labs. They're trying to make heart walls. They're trying to make blood vessels. Is it going to succeed? Yeah. It's going to succeed. Maybe when? Maybe 2 years, 3 years, 4 years. Are they going to be good enough to use? Maybe 5 years. So you can get all your organs replaced. So you can keep drinking single malt without feeling the impact. Nanoparticle jetting technology to 3D printing using combination of metals and ceramics. Now you know that metals and ceramics don't work together, but if you break it up into nanoparticles and start beating them to powder, you can do many things, right? Now even the chip technology is changing from silicon to other material. And you can see these use cases, what is happening. Boston Dynamics has created a robo that can run. They can do a backflip and land on the feet. You must see the video. He will stand, do a backflip and land on his feet. It's incredible. And he can run as fast as the cheetah, 65 kilometers an hour. And then it can use handles to lift, because you know, robots could not lift. They can lift goods, keep it here, stack, do everything else. And you can see that handles objects, climb stairs, will operate in homes, outdoors. This is a business opportunity. But you have to change. Designer babies. We want some leaders to be eternal. We have a 95-year-old leader who wants to be eternal. Maybe you can recreate him. The others who are 74, 75, who want to rule over us for a long time, maybe we need them. But you can see, because of CRISPR technology, you can go edit your DNA. From your DNA, you can remove something and put something else to get you whatever you want. Because the DNA is the machine language to build, right? Initiative to improve internet access as enable spurt. Because what is driving this is that all human beings are coming on one platform where full knowledge is available, consumer, you know, interaction is available, you can do business, you can get enterprise, you can get everything else, a lot of it free, asynchronously, and the tyranny of distance is coming down. OYO, you know what OYO has done, 575,000 hotel rooms. So now Airbnb has got all apartments which are vacant as houses for you to stay. Hotels are getting impacted. Ola has digitized the ecosystem at scale. Why has car buying come down? Partially because Ola cut down the rates. So drivers are not making money, they stop buying cars. Right? They used to buy, Ola, Uber used to buy maybe 200, 250,000 cars every year for the last 3-4 years. Now it's come down to 50,000. And more Ola Uber drives are there, more and more people will stop buying cars. Because they do saturation marketing. If things are available every time, you don't need something else. Clean mobility. So you're seeing multimodal transport for human beings coming through a company called Yulu. Right, Yulu is in Bangalore, by which they have tracked entire networks to find out where people park, where people go, when do they travel, how do they travel, everything else to give last minute connectivity. It's all on a sharing basis. All on a sharing basis. So same vehicle goes 5 times for maybe 5 people. And then you have Ather coming with that electric vehicle in Bangalore. And some people are creating a new bank on top of a bank. Better Place is a platform for blue collar workers. So blue collar work is getting consolidated. Score Data is a company that does, you know, big data analytics, creating a platform to do predictive analysis. Deep Tech. Google is using AI to predict lung cancer through 3D volumetric modeling. So what are they doing? They're trying to check up your lungs by looking at the volume and see how the volume shrinks because of cancer, and then see how to model it to find out on people who may be about to get cancer, whether the probably cancer is there. It detected 5% more cancer cases. Word automates drug discovery process using AI to map genes related to specific diseases. 30% of drugs don't agree with you because of DNA. Now you're going to get DNA designer drugs. You fall ill, they take a piece of a DNA, send it to the cloud, and then they come back and tell you, you must take this drug, and you can take the drug, you become better. Indian companies. There's a machine learning company in Bangalore which has 5 major high volume screening processes using blood smears, urine, semen, etc. to give you pathological reports. So all the pathological labs. So you go take a blood, take a photograph, send it, goes to the cloud, compares, report comes in 10 minutes. You need somebody to sign because, you know, that's a law. Bugworks is finding something in Bangalore for, you know, the superbugs. Airbnb uses neural networks to personalize search. So less houses are going to be built because you don't need them anymore. Because young people may not buy houses, they may go stay in a different house every month. There's enough capacity. Now, companies in music and digitization using machine learning to create weekly personalized playlist. So our mind is sought to be controlled by all these people. Because we are digital data. Our digital persona is available. So we are not human beings, we are a piece of data. We are a piece of data which shows habit, which shows what we do, how we think, how we behave. Because everything is a pattern. Because there is not many people are beyond normal sigma. Everything comes into a pattern. You find enough cases, you get the pattern. For example, we tied up with IBM Watson for oncology in Manipal Hospital. They had 50,000 cases, and we used to send our doctor's diagnosis there. Of course, we are right 98.5% of the time. But with 450,000 cases, they could get 90% of all cases in the world. Why? Because there are not so many unique cases, right? Everything is a pattern. Bloomberg utilizes machine learning to generate social media sentiment. See how the world is changing. Stock market movements happen because of social media. Why? Through social media, you can find out who is thinking, who is doing what, who is sending messages, and track that and input it by an algorithm into stock market trading, and you get something else. Because trading and market activity is based upon greed and fear. Both are emotions. Zendrive uses smartphone sensors to measure and improve driving behavior. Just by a smartphone, when you drive, they can track what you do and do many things. Houndify allows integration of voice and conversational AI. Texico deciphers meaningful pattern to communicate. So marketing is going to be very different tomorrow compared to what it is. See, today there are lots of enterprises. If enterprises shrink and become fewer, that means repeat buying is not there. Right? So the future is fluid and limited only by your imagination. So digitization is rewriting. Now, what is happening in India? Let me take a while. There's a huge amount of capital coming in to drive innovation at the edge. And this is impacting consumers directly. Because consumers are changing behavior. A new generation of buyers is coming up who have got money. And the power of the mobile phone is giving more power to the consumer. And now that is creating new disruptions because the quantum of stock in the system may come down. And it is changing the way businesses behave. Now the drive for electric vehicles will change the car industry and the truck industry in the next 5 to 7 years dramatically. Alright? And then the utility industry will be changed when we have 125,000 megawatts of alternate energy. In June of this year, for the first time in 200 years, the UK ran with alternate energy with no coal being burnt. Coal is gone. Right? Germany uses 30% of its energy by wind and solar and gas, of course. So what happens to oil? If lesser cars are purchased, what happens to oil? If less oil is consumed, what happened in the Middle East? If less oil is consumed, what happened to the shipping? What happens to the pipelines? What happened to the petrol bunks? What happens to insurance, car insurance, if there's more autonomous cars? What happens to life insurance, accident insurance, if accidents come down? So the chain of things that happen, we don't know what is going to happen, but it's happening. And the impact is being felt rather dramatically, and there'll be a wave of consolidation in the industry that is happening in very different ways. So let me talk about the Indian economy. India's GDP today is $2.73 trillion. PPP is $11.4 trillion. We will be $5 trillion. despite all this slowdown. I'll explain why the slowdown is my theory. And we could be $10 trillion, except the rupee dollar rate is a key factor. Otherwise, we'll grow 7.5-8% and 3.5% inflation, 11.5-12%. If you add it up, you know, it's achievable. But will we grow 8%? In 1991, when we opened up, we were $275 billion. In 2019 March, we are $2.73 trillion. We have grown at 8.6% a year in dollar term for 28 years. Delhi doesn't look at data. That's why there's not, people are not talking, but that is the data. So we could grow at that fast pace. What is driving the growth? Consumption and investment. 70% of India's consumption, 30% is investment. Investment has come down in the last 3 to 4 years, primarily because there's excess capacity, because they were built up with the bank loans, and we know with IBC, a lot of things are happening. We know why they were all built, etc., etc., etc. Now, will consumption keep rising? Consumption rises based upon jobs and people's income. Now, people's income going up, inflation is down. Like you said, sir, inflation is down. Why is inflation down? An economist told me that money supply got squeezed by demonetization. So money supply to GDP has come down. And the velocity of increase in money supply has come down. And that's the biggest factor for the last 4 years, the last 3.5 years for inflation to come down. And government borrowing also came down. And then black money generation has come down. Because the real estate after demonetization, if black money was 30%, it's come down to 20%. For traders, it is a 30%, it's come down to 10%. And people are scared because you can track where the money is. So money circulation has come down. So even though total quantum of money has gone up, I think it's 21 lakh crores or whatever it is today, the percent of GDP, it has come down. I think that compared to what it was at one point of time. That's what the economists say. Then what happened? In September, I think, of last year, the ILFS crisis blew up. At the time the ILFS crisis blew up, a lot of the consumer credit was coming through the NBFCs. And the NBFCs were lending to real estate companies, they were lending to supply chain companies, automobile dealers, etc. They're lending to consumers, and they're lending to small businesses, because the banks were not lending too much. A latest report says 40% of incremental consumer lending came through NBFCs in the last financial year. 40%. So banks are not the major lenders. The NBFCs are major lenders. All right? Because it has gone up tremendously. Now, when the ILFS crisis hit, the first impact were the mutual funds, because they were lending money. Because people were going to mutual funds because they're collecting money, they were lending money through CPs, or to short-term lending of 90 days, they stopped because they had to take a hit for ILFS. But ILFS was using short-term money for building roads. It's crazy, but it's happening. So when they got hit, they took a write-off. Then all mutual funds stopped lending more money. They started calling back the money. And mutual fund lending is 25% of the total lending to NBFCs. The NBFCs asset base is 24 lakh crores. The total bank lending is 97 lakh crores. So it is significant. So when the NBFC started calling the money back, it means money going into the market, maybe three to five lakhs crores a year stopped, 50,000, 60,000 crores a month, right? And then they called the money back, paid back the money, it went into maybe bank deposits. So further lending stopped, the money came back, and there is a crunch in the market. So the dealers who stocked cars, they couldn't stock anymore, because the financing for the cars came down. And then people stopped buying. 10%, 15% consumers stopped buying because there's no money to give them credit. It won't work, because banks may give you credit. But today in the dealer shop with the NBFC guy who went and gave you credit immediately, the banks will make you run around, do this, do that, give me this, give me that, right? In the NBFC, they used to see your face and give you the vehicle. Say 25% down, show me Aadhaar card and take the vehicle. Now that has come down. They're not lending anymore. So money is gone out of the system, and there's a gap in the system, and that's why the dealers are shutting down. Because if you look at cars, think about it. You know, we sell 28 lakhs cars a year in India. About 35 lakh cars are made, and they export 700,000, 28 lakh cars, right? Who buys the car? middle class with borrowing, correct? Because they pay in installment, 80-90% borrowing. Not many put a cash down because it's dumb to put a cash down. You can use the money for something else, right? That means out of 137 crore people is something like about maybe, let's say, 28 crore families. 28 into 5, maybe 4.5, 28 crore families. Out of 28 crore families, maybe 5 crore families or 6 crore families are the one who buy cars. They can afford to buy cars. Am I right? 6 into 5, 30 crore people. Correct? That's your market. Others can't buy. They may buy, but very rare. Okay? Out of this 6 crore families, you know, maybe they used to buy a car, they used to replace a car. If 10% of the people who buy a car don't buy a car because there's no money in the market, or they're not getting credit, the car crashes down by 10%. That's point number one. Point number two, because of the BS6, people read newspapers. They're pretty smart. They're waiting for the new model. Because I buy something now, then I can't sell it later in 1st April. And the Supreme Court has said no more change. Correct? That's the point number two. And the third thing which is happening is, for two-wheelers, they drive towards electric vehicles and others. People are very confused. So consumer financing has come down, consumption has come down, and in real estate, there are many marginal people. They got struck by RERA. They got struck by the fact that, you know, high-price apartments are not being bought. Because who bought the high-price apartment? People who had surplus money for investment. Not everything was done by the consumer, correct? They said it'll go up. For the last 3-4 years, real estate has not gone up. So speculators are not putting money. And for the last 3-4 years, bribe money in Delhi has come down. Bribe money has come down. So real estate in Noida, in Gurgaon has come down. Because where did the money go? It went into real estate. It's all come down. Because you go to the UPA too, you could see that, no, price is going up, lot of real estate. Where did the money come from? It's all cash, gone. Correct? So real estate also is seeing a decline in construction, and the jobs have come down in that area. Many of the smaller companies are shutting down. So real estate is impacted, consumer is impacted, auto is impacted, and these are major sectors. And you had, like you told me, three, four years of boom with 30%, can't be good forever. So now industry has to wait for liquidity to come back to the market. Government is trying to do something. It will take some time. So last quarter of last year, GDP grew by 5.8%. First quarter, SBI says, will be 5.6%. They'll announce this month end. This quarter also is gone, maybe 5.2, 5.3%. And unless money comes back by September in the festival season, it could go up to maybe 6%. And then the last quarter of this year, the Kharif crop comes into being, some money come, there could be an uptick. So this year we're not going to grow more than 6%. And the liquidity doesn't improve, the cycle doesn't start again. Because next year we're going to have new vehicles come, BS6 vehicle come, the fuel has to be there. There could be confusion for the first 3 or 4 months. So next year too, the growth could be impacted for the first quarter. So maybe second quarter of next year, we could come back to near normal, what normal being maybe the September quarter of last year. So there is a problem. Everybody is confused. And politically, we are in a mess because in September, when this ILFS blew up, our finance minister was not doing well. Right? And then October, November, December, they tried to do something, but the election fever is going on. Then January, February, March, the election started, campaigning started, nothing happened, government is not working. Right? Then we had the results in May, then we had parliament. New budget, new finance minister, a bit of a mess. Then we had Kashmir. So entire political attention has gone to all these items. Now parliament is closed, budgets are over. You're seeing some kind of talk and some kind of action and some kind of worry coming. And finally, Prime Minister Modi said he's not going to go after people who are wealth creators and, you know, right kind of noises are being made. So consumer finance not being available, money being pulled from the market, and then lack of political action, government which did not take decisions or didn't anticipate, the Reserve Bank of India which kept interest rates very high, all that has come together to create this situation. And at the root of it all is the kind of shocks industry got for the last 4 years. Like I said, demonetization, then you had GST, then you had IBC, then you had the RERA, then you had this BS6, particularly for your industry. Now all that has come together and the impact of that is felt here. And that's why you're feeling a slowdown. And when a slowdown happens, capital goods industry gets hit the most. So what should you do? One, you must create flexible organizations to respond to the market. In your association, have a chief economist who can possibly advise you how the economy is going to go and do some predictions. Second, get into robotics and new forms of manufacturing. See how the world is going. Go to China, go to Tesla, go to cutting-edge manufacturers, see what is happening. Right? And third, reorient your organizational structure. Okay? To put in more money into R&D, a little bit more, and get a few people who can talk about trends and advise you, and lower your fixed cost. Right? Lower your fixed cost. And fourth, try to export more. Invest more money in exporting in other parts of the world where you have may have a competitive advantage. South America comes to mind. Right? Maybe Southeast Asia comes to mind, where people are still spending money buying some machines and doing things because they're way behind. Now, the world has changed. Now, all these, are they short-term, long-term measures? They're short-term measures. In the long term, there's going to be new ways of manufacturing for which all of us have to get prepared. Manufacturing will remain. It's not going to go away. We need goods, we need services. But the way things are manufactured will change. The life of the manufactured good will change. The quantum of the manufactured good will change. Quantum is going to come down. So broad consumption trends will come down because usage of assets will go up. When there's aggregation of demand and easier discovery, usage of assets will go up. And that usage of assets going up means lesser capital assets are required. Right? Any questions? Well, it's been happening for some time. If you think government has got thinking, you're mistaken. I wish government had more thinking. Let me tell you, let me make a statement. Government of India does not have the capacity or the capability to manage a fast-growing economy in an extremely complex world. They're not invested enough. They're not abreast of trends. They're behind the curve. Because India is a very, very complex country. There are 300 million people who are on par with the rest of the world. Another 300 million people who want to be where the first 300 million are. And the rest are way behind. Now you've got to cater to all of them, take on the future, and invest for the future, and get ready and compete with the big beast China. It's a very, very difficult task. You've got to think and work at different levels, which unfortunately requires capacity in the government to get policies, to move fast, to remove impediments to business, understand what is happening. For example, the RBI makes a fortnightly statistical analysis of bank deposits and bank lending, but they don't do it for NBFCs. They don't do it for mutual funds. Savings in mutual funds are going up. Every year, 5 to 6 lakh crores is coming there. They're not tracking it. They're not tracking lending by NBFCs. So they're saying the system liquidity, RBI governor says the system liquidity, the DFS system liquidity, the liquidity. But the banks are not lending. Lending is by NBFCs. NBFCs don't have liquidity. So where is liquidity?
Indirect tax revolution caused by GST is yet to mature, and Government of India is bringing a new direct state tax code. Is it not too much for a nation like India to digest so many reforms?
See, the direct tax code hopefully will reduce tax terrorism. Because tax terrorism now, you know, after I wrote that article and we spoke up on TV, we sent a 6-point program to government. 1 point has been done. That means the threshold for appeals has gone up. To appeal to High Court has gone to 1 crore from 50 lakhs, to Supreme Court 2 crores from 1 crore, to Tribunal from 20 lakhs has gone to 50 lakhs. So smaller cases will go away. Now they're looking at how to isolate remote tax terrorism because they're very concerned. I think that will improve, and the new tax code will reduce many of the big things that have happened. Hopefully life could be better. There is hope, because I think Prime Minister Modi is very intent on making it happen. So the new tax code will be good. That will be good. It will reduce your taxes too, hopefully, and improve many of the things. Improve compliance, improve this thing. The GST's problem is, the GST is an over-engineered product. Filing is very difficult. It's not because of technology. Infosys did a fabulous job. It's because the design of that was get to bureaucrats, and the bureaucrat made it so complicated because they give me this, give me that, give me that. They never thought of users. And because of that, you know, because they don't want to make it simple. They make it simple, their power is gone. That's why the state government officers want power, central government, everybody wants power. Now I hear to get refunds, they're asking for some things, right? Some people told me, to get a refund, you go meet them, they said, baat karenge. So anywhere there's a discussion in the hands of officials. So there's a tussle between the political leaders and these people about what has to be done. That's why we need more people from industry to stand up and to talk and to point out and to work, to do well. Because I believe our political leaders want good things for us. But execution is by the bureaucracy. And their mindset has not changed. They're still in the control era. Yes, sir.
So one more question by Mr. K.L. Adu. Is there a case for complete abolition of Indian income tax?
No. I keep getting the stupid suggestion there. Let me tell you why. The total income tax is 6 lakh crores. 6 lakh crores on 1 crore, 90 lakh crores is maybe 3.25% of GDP. What are you going to replace it with? Right? 12 lakh crores is the total income tax and corporate tax. What are you going to replace with? The big hole. You can't make a transaction tax. You'll never get that money. All that is lousy calculations. It's not going to work. See, the income tax has to be at reasonable levels because it is on income that you earn. Now, you can't tax consumption out of existence. Correct? Because people only when people buy more, volumes go up, you become a big economy, etc. For that, costs have to come down. In fact, the average tax after GST has come down by 3%. Average tax has come down by 3%. FMCG companies are showing a 3% reduction in the total tax paid. They've seen an increase in margins, but now demand has come down, that's a problem. So I don't think that's workable.